So I was made aware that there is also a laser here, but I think the arrow of the mouse work as well as the laser, so I think we're good so far. So sometimes endemic species carry problems for our domestic animals, and possibly vice versa. But opossums, you know, carry Sarcocystis neurona, which in the past had some name changes, Falcatula, then back to Neurona, now they're their own species. And I was mentioning before, in 1992 in Newmarket, with Dr. Whitwell and Dr. Professor Ken Smith, we observed this case of severe neurologic disease in a filly from United States, just imported. And when we opened up the examined CNS, we found some lesions that at the time in Europe they were not very common. You see, the lesion is unilateral, involves the brainstem, and there is a large area of hemorrhagic malation. So, and when we observed histologically, we found the highly suggestive, if not pathognomonic lesions, I would say highly suggestive, after we saw later in the years, of equine protozoal encephalomyelitis, EPM, which at the time was only associated with Sarcocystis neurona. So a case from the United States in England. The disease was already profoundly studied in the United States at the time. This is a case at Cornell University from the King de la Hanta collection. And you can see that here there is a large area of hemorrhagic necrosis. We don't see these cases anymore. So fortunately for the horse, unfortunately for the pathologist, we don't see flooring cases anymore because these animals get treated. So as soon as an animal becomes neurologic, the vet, United States, uses the right drugs to neutralize the parasites. The parasites is very sensitive to treatment, and so you're left often with, instead of seeing malacia, lymphocytes, plasma cells, neutrophil, and the famous eosinophils, which are the signature of the infection, you are left with horses being euthanized anyway because it was not safe to ride anymore. And often you find just a few lymphocytes and plasma cells around a few blood vessels. And often the site of infection, like in this case, is not so visible anymore. In fact, the trimming, the preparation of the brain and spinal cord, it takes a long time. You need to remove the whole brain and spinal cord, which is a lot of work. And then you need to fix everything formally. You need to collect your tissues, of course, for additional molecular virology. And then, as soon as everything is partially fixed, you start slicing. And then you need to dissect the spinal cord centimeter by centimeter, inch by inch, or even less, and look. Because sometimes you can have a focus hemorrhagic necrosis, just caudal, it's unpredictable. Often the clinical neurologist, the SCDIM person that sends you the horse is good enough to, they're good people. They tell you where the lesion could be, but often it's not the case. Not because they're not good, because you can have multifocal changes. And it's the only infectious disease of the horse, in addition to abscesses, which are less frequent even, where the lesion is not symmetrical generally, and it can involve just a small portion of the CNS with dramatic results, dramatic clinical signs. And another case, here in the basal nuclei, and here with a Lagniappe lesion. Lagniappe in Louisiana means something on the top, a gift. And so an incidental cholesteatoma. But here clearly there is an area of hemorrhagic necrosis, malacia, and it's asymmetrical. So it's asymmetrical, you know you're not dealing with something zoonotic, most likely. And what you see at the microscope, you can see all the changes just mentioned histologically, But keep an eye to eosinophils. Eosinophils will tell you that this is most likely sarcosis neurona. Why did they say most likely? Because recently we had some equine cases of Angiostrongylus cantonensis. And Angiostrongylus cantonensis is the longworm or rats, which has been brought to New Orleans and Louisiana, probably with ships, because it's a very important harbor. And then unfortunately, occasionally induced larval migration or adult migration in larval migration, I believe, to the CNS of animals, little mammals, but also some adults, some large animals. And so they also show eosinophils in Malaysia. So you want to be conservative. And then with immunohistochemistry, if you are lucky, you can find the zoites, which is monoclonal specific for T sarcosis neurona, and then cysts, but there are not many organisms. Another feature that you can see in these infections, if the animal has not been treated, you remember the giant cells I show you with the experimental infection with equine infectious anemia? You can see the same giant cells, especially with EPM. And the location is unpredictable. It can be from the rhinencephalon to the cauda equina, right? Then Amiralia Amir described in one case of protozoal infection horses to Neospora ugazi. So here is I didn't have any Neospora case in horses, but just put your picture here of a cyst of Neospora in the brain of a calf. Without lesion in this case. There is a zoite here, there is a cyst here. We see it mainly as a sporadic cause of abortion in cattle and in immunosuppressed dogs which get systemic neosporosis when they get treated with high level of corticosteroids or other immunosuppressive drugs. But just to be complete, I put you a picture of Neospora. I wouldn't bet on it. Instead, in South America, Trypanosoma evansii can induce severe encephalomyelitis in horses. In this nice manuscript published on veterinary pathology by Professor Claudio Barros. And here are the parasites within the bloodstream. This is a horse which is a taxi, the classic Brazilian background, and the fields. And then here, severe lesions in the lower portion of this encephalon, asymmetrical lesion, yellowish discoloration, which indicate hemorrhages, indicates macrophages with the mucidary most likely, Malaysia. You see, very severe lesion. Look at the swelling. Very florid inflammation. I don't think this horse was treated. Maybe other horses were involved. Lymphocytes, and you start seeing plasma cells. Because with viral infections, we didn't see plasma cells, except with equine infection anemia. And here with protozoa, yes, you'll see the plasma cells, even being a horse. Claudio Barros, Universidade Federal de Santa Maria. Probably best school in Brazil, one of the best vet schools in Brazil. And courtesy of Professor Uzal at California, the California Diagnostic System, at CAS, over there. And strangely, we don't see them in Louisiana, which is pretty much the heaven for this kind of protozoa, a necrotizing cortical encephalitis due to amoeba. And you can have various amoebas that can induce these lesions in animals and humans. And yesterday, Michael Gardner gave a very interesting review of these infections, detectable with immunohistochemistry and fluorescent antibodies. In this case, a cantamoeba in a sheep brain in Malaysia. The organism, the cysts, the FA identification, the lesion in a necrotizing lesion in a horse. This is also one of my board slides where I took my board examination in Iowa. Never forget that case. Very tricky because with Aichani, you don't see them immediately. You see this encephalic destruction, You see the malacia, you see the inflammation, and eventually you start seeing a few things, a few ghost cells that may look like something, and then eventually you identify one which is better than the other, and then you see them all. But they're not immediate. And this picture, Dr. Reed at UC Davis, show you the severity of the in the Cornell University Neuropathology Collection, which is available online. Severe blue discoloration due to a perivascular infiltration of the gliosis, you see. Very dramatic focal lesion in this case. Lots of Gitter cells, multinucleated cells, lymphocyte plasma cells, some eosinophils. And then the organisms. In this case, Balamutia, most likely Balamutia mandrillaris. And then it is nice in direct immunohistochemistry from the Professor Uzal lab, some perivascular organisms. And then a lot of organisms in this severely affected meningeal and parenchymal area with cavitation and neutrophils. We have cases every year in humans. Children, occasional adults, swimming in ponds, which are very good looking ponds, but in August in South United States, they're very warm, and that's part of the pleasure to swim in them. But there are nesting ground for these protozoa, and if you nail the water, these protozoa are very able to pass the lamina cribrosa of the ethmoid and then penetrate through the rhinencephalon and induce these dramatic lesions. We had even a case of a young man that was inhaling some tap water, and in Baton Rouge the water is excellent, probably the best water in the United States, but if you drive a few miles toward New Orleans, the water has got a different source, so you need to be careful, because if the chlorine level are not high enough, I assume you can have some organism, and so it deposits directly this tap water within the nose, and it got the infection, unfortunately died. So be always aware, swim in these ponds with head above water, so be careful. Then we have abscesses within the brain or within the vertebral column and spinal cord due to Streptococcus equi. Can be Streptococcus equi, rarely Streptococcus equi zooepidemicus, even more rarely, probably isolated, not in the CNS yet, Streptococcus equisimilis. These are the three cocci of horses. Equi is the responsible of that dramatic contagious streptococcal disease of horses, which then is also associated with purpura hemorrhagica. And then occasionally we get abscesses, but associated with a penetrating lesion, like a projectile. In this case, a piece of wood that during a storm was able to penetrate the calvarium and induce this mixed bacterial infection. A suppurative lesion, see the how flaccid the parenchyma is, how brownish is the exudate. This was purely cocci, and this was mixed bacteria, which is coming from the external portion. Rhodococcus, streptococcus tend to have a soft, whitish, yellowish appearance. Rhodococcus, which also responsible for meningoencephalitis, rarely, tend to have more caseous and brownish appearance, but don't quote me on this because you may have surprises. And abscesses, in this picture of Dr. Habecker, New Bolton Center, been my colleague for 12 years, great person, great pathologist. In this case, these two abscesses are compressing the spinal cord. Rare, but it happened. And Rhodococcus equi, rarely, because you know Rhodococcus equi mainly induce caseous, pyogranulomatous, bronchopneumonia, lymphadenitis, can induce an uveitis or caseous ulcerative enterocolitis, can induce this pyogranulomatous meningoencephalitis, but it's rare. I always emphasize Rhodococcus equi to my students, and also emphasized the similarity between Rhodococcus equine lesions, Streptococcus equine lesions, and Salmonella lesions, because they got a lot in common. They all can form abscesses and areal necrosis. They all hit similar systems, and the most similar probably Rhodococcus and Salmonella, which can hit almost all the systems. They both induce also abortion like Streptococcus, and the gross aspect and histopathology are highly suggestive of their differences. Both Rhodococcus and Salmonella can cause pneumonia, which can be necrotizing, but generally in Rhodococcus, pyroromatous in cases. With Dr. Langer, we discovered that occasionally Salmonella can induce the same lesion the lung that Rhodococcus does histologically. So we're very surprised, but it's rare. Then they all induce lymphadenitis, hepatitis with abscesses, as I mentioned, meningoencephalitis rarely, uveitis, ophthalmitis. All these agents I mentioned can induce very destructive osteomyelitis, especially Salmonella, and osteoarthritis. Rhodococcus can induce a very destructive osteoarthritis, and then they all induce abortion. Rhodococcus very rarely, Salmonella in the past more very frequently, now is sporadic, and Streptococcus epidemicus can induce frequently necrosuppurative placentitis and fetal sepsis. So, very interesting diseases. Sorry for the digression, but it's something very important in equine pathology. And then, this horse was a two-year-old that had guttural pouch, a suppurative guttural cystitis, which would be the inflammation of guttural pouches. There are several ways to define the inflammation of guttural pouches. I learned guttural cystitis in Milan, but some people call it in different ways. Could be Eustachian diverticulitis even, so depends which kind of training you have. And in this case, the infection was so severe and so erosive and ulcerative that the pus and the bacteria were able to get the carotid artery and embolize on one section of the cortex with this clear yellowish-brownish discoloration and hyperemian hemorrhage because of this embolic shower of neutrophil, macrophages, and bacteria. It was a mixed bacterial population. It was not only cocci, it was also bacilli and probably something similar to Fusobacterium. In fact, the microbiologist said something, and we morphologically saw much more. So remember that microbiology is very useful, but it's not the final answer. Your eye is often the final answer. Maybe you don't know the name of the bacteria that are there, but you can see how many they are, which kind of shape the heart. So I get a Streptococcus equi, if I recall, from isolation in a bacillum. We saw at least four type of bacterial morphology. The same cross-section, you see, severely hemorrhagic, which indicates the vascular involvement, the embolism. And here a blood vessel with thrombosis, severe meningitis, and then a bacterial embolus. And then vasculitis. And I don't have the silver stain, but multiple bacterial species. Then remember that in the brain you can see a mycotic lesion. This is an Aspergillus hyphae associated with hemorrhagic lesion. And this was in absence of inflammation. Which kind of lesion you're going to look for in this horse? You get the brain, you get a little block, you get a little specimens, because they saw a reddish area. That's not going to happen because they're going to see much more before they collect the brain. But where you're going to, which are the two sites where you're going to look for lesions in this horse? You got hyphae in the brain. Where is hyphae coming from? There is a primary lesion which induces a secondary fungal growth, which then expands systemically, most likely to the brain. Not all the cases.
So there are
What's that?
Guttural pouch.
You said uterus?
Guttural pouch.
Oh, guttural pouch. Well, that's a good idea. But generally doesn't go to the brain from there. But it's a great, it's a different perspective, I appreciate it. Generally, in Salmonella enterocolitis, necrotized enterocolitis, you got severe leukopenia. And the spores that are naturally present in the lung of several species, including horses, this dramatic leukopenia favor a mycotic pneumonia. And this fungal hyphae that grows very floridly, in a very florid way, then can embolize in other districts, including the brain. So the classic combination described by Olafs, by Slauson in the 80s on an interesting manuscript where there is necrotizing colitis due to Salmonella, immunosuppression, mycotic pneumonia as a combination, and then distribution hyphae alone in certain cases. And then in horses, you can see the famous pathogenic yeast, the four forms, which has been mentioned very well yesterday by my colleague. You can blastomyces, blastomyces, dermatitis, histoplasma, and rhodococcus, cryptococcus, and blastomyces. They're not so frequent, but if you're going to find one, it's going to be a papillomatous meningoencephalitis due to cryptococcus. And this image of Professor John King, it's clear that the exudate is very thick, and this thickness is most likely given to the capsule that is it's given by the capsule of the yeast, which is expressing macroscopically in the exudate, which also involves the gyri. And similar lesions you can see them in humans and in cats, not necessarily only at cerebral level. And then another, in cross-section, which is not present here, unfortunately, you could see multiple cavitations. And then rarely, in dogs and cattle and horses, more frequently in dogs, you can see Prototica, which is a alga without chlorophyll, which developed particularly in Central Europe after long days, generally many days of raining, so there is a blossoming of this organism. You start seeing them multisystemical in dogs, and rarely, very rarely, has been described in horses. Classic evidence of the various organisms, which when they are together, sometimes they have a shape that suggests the Mercedes, the car company, the Mercedes-Benz sign, you know, with the chicken finger there, the digit. And then we can have lesions due to toxicity mainly, because they're not infections. Classic leukoencephalomalacia, necrosis, malacia, the white matter, due to fumonisin B1, which is present on the feedstuff of the horse, especially corn. In fact, it's called moldy corn poisoning. And the toxins induce elective necrosis of the white matter. Interestingly, this toxin, fumonisin B1, there are many fumonisin from Fusarium moniliforme and Fusarium roseum, which are these fungi that grow on the corn and other feedstuff. There are several toxins, but fumonisin B1 is the most powerful. And interestingly, the horse-induced necrosis of the white matter of the brain, and in pigs induce pulmonary edema. So different species, different lesions. So always kind of interesting presentation. We had a case recently, a couple of cases a few years ago at LSU and elsewhere. And this is one of the diseases that you know what you're dealing with when you pretty much get the brain in your hand. This is something the horse you cannot mistake, because when you try to remove the brain from the cranial cavity, it falls apart. You see, well, this horse will be euthanized 15 minutes ago. and the brain is falling apart. First of all, the brain doesn't fall apart generally, it gets liquefied, so it's a different type of autolysis. But this is a real severe lesion you can detect immediately. Then histology is not even confirmatory, because gross lesions are even more interesting than histologic lesion. And then, in the United States, they imported many years ago these Mediterranean plants of the genus Centaurea, Centaurea solstitialis, or Acroptilion, and they're called names like Russian knapweed. In reality, they are plants of our Mediterranean, which they've been importing them probably for question of garden, for something like this. The problem is the West United States, these plants expanded very florid, in a very florid way, and horses sometimes consume these plants, and the alkaloids of these plants are able to target these nuclei. So by the location of this necrotic lesion, this specific malacia, the disease is called nigropallidal encephalomalacia. So sometimes you want to keep an eye, because sometimes horses reject these plants because it's got something nicer to eat. But sometimes, even in absence of the good plants, they don't touch them, but there are some horses that even eat them if they got other things available. So like people, got different characters, so different behaviors. And interestingly, and you probably will not, at least in areas of good parasitic management, these lesions are not available anymore. And that's a picture of 1994. That was a pony that had a severe brain hemorrhage. And then opening the base of the aorta near the carotid artery. So you see, these are the valves and this is the base of the aorta. We found a granuloma, which happened to be a parasitic granuloma due to Strongylus vulgaris, that ruptured and this cap fragmented and went on the carotid artery asymmetrically, induced this brain infarct. That's one of the few causes of brain infarcts in horses, because horses, unlike humans, they eat vegetables, so they have a healthy life, they do a lot of sport, they don't eat meat, so they don't get ictus like in humans. And occasionally, especially in the past, we had the opportunity to see these old infarcts, which were probably due to these parasitic granulomas that were embolizing. So this was a fatal lesion, this pony. This was just an incidental finding, a horse that happened to be an lymphoma also in the brain, but this was an area most likely due to an old infarct with the same pathogenesis, but non-fatal. And in fact, it's not difficult, it's pretty difficult to find these days, these cases of cerebrospinal nematodiasis due to Strongylus. Now we've got three strongyli, large Strongyli, vulgaris, equinus, edentatus, or edentatus, depending on pronunciation. And in this case, with no reaction, just a little bit of lymphocyte plasma cells and eosinophils around this blood vessel. In this case, image that I got from the Dr. Cho collection, LSU, this kind of hemorrhagic multifocal lesion, which could be anything else, could be virus, could be protozoa, in this case happened to be Strongylus vulgaris. So it's good that ivermectin and other products really clean up the parasitic population from our horses. I spent 12 years at the University of Pennsylvania, where the horses were so managed in that area that parasites were really a treat. Now back to Louisiana, different climate, more parasitic infection, but I don't see these things frequently anymore, like in the early 80s. And something that is really highly pathogenic for horses and humans and a few other species, make sure which kind of mud you put your foot in, equine or human, because there is a free-living nematode called Alicephalobus gingivalis, when you are a student, we are calling micronema dielectric, that is able to penetrate the skin and go to the kidney, to the brain, and to the eye, and induce very destructive granulomatous lesions. In this case, just the parasites in cross-section with not much disturbance, but you see that digging into the brain, and then in here more severely. And we had a case that we published where the mare had it, and also the lesion in the mammary gland, and then the foal suckling got the parasite, died later. So first we did the autopsy of the mare, and then the foal was examined in Kentucky later. Alicephalus gingivalis, the females tend to do this kind of paratenic host infestation. It is a kidney. I took this picture when I was visiting Michigan State University. And so the senior pathologist in the case is Tony Mulaney. You can see how this kidney is effaced. Your differential diagnosis will be renal carcinoma, lymphoma, myeloproliferative disease, or any granulomatous disease due to fungus or parasites. Look at the destruction of the parenchyma. And the same thing can be done to the eye, to the brain, to the skin. Alicephalobus dielectrix, present in Europe. Professor Cantile published a case in the 90s. And he was able to identify the parasites because he spinned the material that was on the bottom of the container where the horse tissues were. So he was able to spin the formalin fixed material was at the base of the container, and then the parasitology identified the rhabditiform parasite as Alicephalobus gingivalis. Very interesting European case. Case report on the now defunct European Journal of Veterinary Pathology, which lasted for a few years, which was the original journal of the European College of Veterinary Pathologists and the European Society, and now Veterinary Pathology, which is the American College Veterinary Journal, is the official organ of publication of three colleges, ACVP, ECVP, and Japanese College. So then, in the United States, we sporadically find these parasites migrating erratically in the brain of sheep, goats, llamas, and alpacas, induce meningoencephalitis. But occasionally, Paraphosphorangulus tenuis, which is a normal common parasite of Cervus virginianus, which is the white-tailed deer in the United States, it can be picked up by non-specific host and induce lesions in the CNS. And sporadically, remember two or three cases, we can see it in horses. So the adult is normally present at the level of the meninges in deer, and where it doesn't induce much damage, so it's supposed to be there. Lucky shot, when I was in Cornell as a resident, remove a brain and I found this guy on the meninges, so very lucky finding. And they form tracks. So anytime you see a hole in a CNS, in a brain, a spinal cord, consider a larvae which is migrating. Don't be surprised that if you don't see inflammation, keep looking, keep trimming, you may find something. You see? Spheroids, Malaysia, Gitter cells. And then, if you're lucky, you find these lesions, granulomas, where the parasite eventually died and get attacked by the macrophages, and there is an attempt to surround the dead parasite. And then, if you're lucky, like in other lesions, the skin due to abronema, drasia, you can find remnants of the nematode, and with plenty of exudate. See, the former worm that now is necrotic, but still you see some structures. And at this point, you know, it's difficult to say what this was, but based on the extension of the lesion, I think there's a good presumptive diagnosis of Elaphostrangulus tenuis, paratenic infection. Look at the palisading macrophages here. Equine degenerative myelencephalopathy, EDM, not so frequent, specific in certain breeds, specific location here in this brainstem portion, you know, this vitamin E responsive disease has got this localization in the brainstem, in the brainstem spinal cord, with loss of fiber bilaterally, dorsolaterally, and ventrally. And these are the location here, brainstem, cervical tract, and thoracolumbar. Some breeds are more prone to develop it. Some people mention Morgan horses. Don't quote me on this, just gossip at meetings. But you know, good people, so I trust their opinion. Great clinicians in the United States. And then here the demyelination is present in the medulla and spinal cord, especially in the cervical mid-thoracic lesion, and with Luxofast-Blue or Bielowski or Bielkowski stain, you can, which the silver, you can see the demyelination. You can see spheroids and chromatolysis. This picture of the Cornell University collection, put together by Clive Huxtable years ago. And then a disease that I know pretty well because when I was a resident in Cornell, they were studying it. In the late 80s, in Brazil, a bunch of horses of the military service started observing a disease which was inducing muscle atrophy and instability in horses. So I think they contacted Cornell University, Dr. Hunter and Dr. Divers there, and then progressively they realized that this condition was very similar to Lou Gehrig disease of humans, with CNS involvement, especially the motor neuron, which were characterized by chromatolysis, inclusion bodies, reddish inclusion bodies, non-viral, just degenerative, lots of lipofuscin, glial scars, and muscle atrophy. And the muscle atrophy is especially involving the coccygia, where you can get a biopsy and get a presumptive diagnosis with a muscle biopsy, quadriceps, triceps brachii, and also lipofuscinosis in the eyes, some lipofuscin in the liver, and also some lipofuscins in the intestine. We observed in Cornell University in the early 90s. I had quite a few cases. And classic presentation in a painted horse with the tail that is broad like a halfway flag. The poor horse cannot raise the tail much. And they tend to bring their feet under their body because they got some instability and weakness. The aspect of the skeletal muscle near the bone of the involved muscle would be this one, gelatinous and yellowish, highly suggestive of the disease, and indicating definitely a neurogenic atrophy. Histologically, the muscle would be characterized by small angular fibers, small groups. So you put together the histologic lesion in the CNS and the muscle lesion, you have the disease, and was associated with deficient food deficient in vitamin E. And I think Cornell, they were able to reproduce the disease in a few animals. Here is the histologic feature, which is very similar to porcine motor neuron disease and human, and chromatolysis. Normal neuron, look at the beauty, the nissl substance, thyroid appearance. Here, there is the neuron is not recognizable. It's chromatolytic, and then the fiber with myelin fragmentation, occasional myelomacrophages, and when the process healed, there is a scar comprised by Schwann cells only, so you see, you don't see the fibers anymore, but you see a series of nuclei of Schwann cells pile up, indicating the fiber loss. And when you lose a neuron, often you have a scar, and often there are some macrophages in the CNS that replace that neuronal body, with that Nagiot body that I show you when I describe rabies at the beginning of the presentation. Then we have cerebellar amyotrophy in Arab horses and a few other breeds. See that the vermis is thinner. These sulci shouldn't be there. They're born normal. And then at 6 months, they show the most prominent clinical signs of ataxia. Cerebellar abiotrophy. Not atrophy, abiotrophy. It's a symmetrical, progressive lesion. Arab horses. And here, the cerebellum shows that young animal with decreased number of Purkinje cells, thinner folia. See, this granular layer was supposed to be migrating here. A few don't migrate, a few, at the beginning, there is not a sufficient number. And then, believe it or not, there are a couple of publications, even two publications, on this incidental finding of horses. I think one was enough. But if you examine the brain of horses, adults generally, some also not so old horses, present this absolutely non-significant but clearly visible mineralization around the blood vessels of the pallidus area. So don't be afraid, it's an incidental finding. Look at it, like asteroid bodies in horses. You probably do strongylus vulgaris. We don't know what caused this. And just keep going, because this horse would be, this is not a significant lesion. We never saw these vessels rupturing. Hydrocephalus. This is a Dr. King picture. Finally, I got a couple hydrocephalus in foals. Waited 30 years to get my own picture. In dogs, we see once every month or even more, and in pigs also, but in cattle sporadically. Horses don't get it very frequently, but it may occur. That's borderline hydrocephalosporencephaly. We see also hydroencephaly in horses sporadically. Pigs, humans, small ruminants and larger ruminants have viral diseases inducing brain malformations. Didn't see much of this in horses, okay? That's probably because these congenital anomalies are so rare. And this is a picture of a unique case from many years ago from Professor Sanna Passino, now is the Dean of University of Sassari. And we should have another European meeting there. Sardinia is a fantastic place. And like Corsica or Sicily. And that's a meningocele in this young horse. Dramatic. Once in a lifetime, right? Microphthalmia, case I had at New Bolton Center in 2000. When I came back to use the block for something more elevated than a diagnosis, they told me they toss away the blocks. So never toss away your collection. Cornell, we have blocks from the 60s, and at Louisiana State University, we got blocks that come, that it's been saved from the beginning of our diagnostic service. So, microphthalmia, which is a virus-related lesion in cattle, BVD, in horses, just sporadic event. All the ocular structures were present, but the eye was one-third of the size. And the lesion was bilateral. This is a condition we see now less frequently, at least in the areas where I do diagnostics. You can see that the neurons are shrunken and red. Remember, red is dead. So this is acute cerebral cortical necrosis. This is a perinatal asphyxia. These folds are non-responsive. They're called dummy falls, and they're often associated with dystocia and poor resuscitation attempts. Or sometimes the resuscitation is so persistent that they tend to keep going for horses where the mentation is not there anymore because of this severe necrosis. So dummy foals, the newborn foals don't have many interesting cerebral lesions. Generally, they got very interesting respiratory lesions, some interesting viral infection, but the brain generally doesn't have many lesions. Because I told you, malformations are rare, but it's something to look in the cortex. And probably we all grew up in the 80s with the lecture of our mentors that had these great cases of cholesteatomas, and we don't know what caused them. The difference is that if in the past we had severe cases, which were not associated with clinical sign, but were dramatic cases like this one from the Professor King collection, well, now the biggest cases we see are this one, with minimal dilatation of the ventricle, and the pathogenesis is unknown. My mentor in Milan, Professor Giancarlo Mandelli, that now is his late 80s, a great pathologist, and he speculated that these cases were more frequent in the past because horses were wearing some heavy collar that maybe were inducing some disturbances of jugular circulation, but in reality we don't know. Histologically, hemosiderophages, a little bit of edema, and lots of cholesterol. In reality we don't see the cholesterol, we see the cleft left by cholesterol. So probably some vascular impairment which induce the deposition of this cholesterol material, but that doesn't affect the horse. Cervical vertebral malformation and malarticulation with stenotic compressed cervical myelopathy. Within 1 year of age generally, cervical lesion between C3 and C5, C6. Thoroughbreds and standardbreds. They are generally male, they're big, they're, you know, classic young teenager behavior, they're feisty, they eat a lot, good nutritional condition, grows very fast. First, they develop a dysplasia of the vertebral bones. This induces malarticulation. Disease study in a lot in the late 70s, and then surgery attempt in the 80s and also 90s. And then this can induce compressions varying degrees that can be static, like this one, where there is a continuous mild to moderate compression of the spinal cord, or dynamic, so the horse is affected when it moves the neck. And we still see it regularly. So necropsy is very easy, since there is no part of research going on now, so you don't have to do the whole spinal cord. Decapitate the horse, get the neck, cut the neck from the body after your examination, of course. Split the neck asymmetrically so you can reveal the whole spinal cord, and you check for compression site, you evaluate the vertebral shape, and often you're not lucky, like in this case, the lesions are mild, you pull out the spinal cord, open up the meninges on the top, put everything on your metal table, get your finger and pass your finger on the top of the spinal cord, you may see you may feel a phobia. Where you suspect a compression site, make sure, in addition to trimming other parts of the spinal cord, that you make a section in the middle of the compression, in front of the compression, and caudal to the compression. Cranially, you'll find loss of fibers in the dorsal portion of the spinal cord, dorsolateral, symmetric. In the middle, all the fiber will be affected to various degrees, with spheroids, myelomacrophages, and then caudally, you'll find the ventral fibers which are affected. Easy. So, if you know your stuff, and it's a severe lesion, two, three slides will give you an answer. Insurance company will be happy, owner will be happy, clinician will be happy, and of course, I look at the brain, I look at the distal spinal cord. We are an academia, so we have resident to train, to show it things, but pretty much that's a good job. If you make a diagnosis grossly, I mean, if your legal system allowed you to do that, which it should, probably sufficient. Case like this, there is no doubt, right? But I generally tend to have a complete examination of the case because there are always, I can give you a copy of the picture if you want, with my signature. Still taking picture. He's present, he's in my book, my Equine Atlas, Burdel del Piero, there are all these pictures available in the ebook. So we prefer to do a complete necropsy. You always find something additional, no? Especially in the legal cases, you know, you can find some additional features. In the past, when we were studying the disease, we, other people before me, especially in England and in Cornell and in Florida, they were disarticulating the neck of these horses. Can you believe to be on duty when you have the scientists studying wobbler disease and have to disarticulate all the vertebral body just to perform diagnostics, maybe without recognition, the final paper? What a nightmare. I'm glad I came later in my training. And I want to show you this picture because occasionally, rarely, the compression is lateral, is not dorsal or ventral, is lateral asymmetrical. And I have a couple of cases that I detected in the proximal thoracic portion. Difficult to understand how it developed, the compression. Probably a vertebral asymmetrical dysplasia. And in this case, the lesion is chronic. So this horse survived quite a bit. See, there is loss of tissue. This brownish discoloration would indicate macrophages, fiber loss, and there was even a moderate fibrous tissue proliferation around the blood vessels. 1994, picture with Dr. Dalhanta, Cornell University, C6-7. That's what, should take a better picture. There's a little bit of impurity here, sorry about that. And where are we here? Are we here in front of the compression or behind the compression? Behind. Very good. Because the lesion is ventral. Interestingly, you take some pictures, and for the period of time you're taking the picture, the quality is good. And then years goes, and then you find effects. So you keep taking pictures. So our collections is a never-ending effort. This, I took this picture at the Annual Health Trust in 1992 with the permission of Dr. Whitwell, Catherine Whitwell, one of the best equine pathologists we ever had on this planet. And Dr. Whitwell is so good, because still in the business, and that she is also dissecting the vertebral column of fetuses. So, if you are so careful and detailed your examination, you can find even this Rooney type 1 lesion in the cervical portion of an equine fetus. So in this case, this is a fetus with a compressed stenotic myopia. So kudos to Dr. Whitwell to do a complete necropsy and giving to posterity this wonderful specimen, which was in her office informally. So with her permission, I took this picture in 1992. And now I'm able to show it to you. That's a Rooney type 1, because Professor Rooney was a great equine pathologist. There is an interesting book about equine pathology published by Dr. Rooney in the mid-90s, Rooney Robertson, which is a book I recommend you to read if you're interested in pathology courses, with references that are not only in English, but Russian papers, German papers. So, because you all know that equine sciences blossom first in Eastern Europe. I had a mentor in Milan in the 80s, Dr. Bassignana, who at the time was already 90, so he saw everything. So veterinary medicine blossoming in Central Europe. And I told him, I keep reading these great German papers about equine pathology and you know, this new approach to colic surgery, because there was Dr. Uskamp that was start opening up horses in the 80s and solving cases that were not solved before. And I said, well, the German school is great. He said, yes, they're good, but they learned the majority of their things, the things they learned in the past was from the Russians. Is that we? So there was a very large Russian publication of cases at the beginning of the 1900 veterinary science that we couldn't read because they were in Russian, that you could read now. So, but lots of equine studies before England, before United States, where came large part of the study in Germany, but even before, north of Italy, but also in Russia. So this this book of Dr. Rooney has got references in any type of languages. The guy was amazing. And then that's a fetus that I had the pleasure to examine at the Animal Health Trust. So we pretty much examined also the spinal cord. See, background, old-fashioned, wood painted. And there was trauma. So CNS lesion in a fetus. So probably this fetus aborted for other reasons, but when came out, also had a severe cervical lesion, hemorrhagic lesion. We have also this condition, which is called post-anesthetic hemorrhagic myelopathy, which involves horses that are undergoing surgery. It's happened during anesthesia on the anesthetic table. They wake up with this severe hemorrhagic lesions, posture, ischemia, pathogenesis is a little bit unclear, but it's called post-anesthetic hemorrhagic myelopathy. I had a couple of cases in my career, and before you say something, you want to do histology, and maybe some molecular testing, because this could be one of the viral encephalitis or protozoal diseases that I just mentioned. Disc herniation, it's happened occasionally. I noted in generally large breeds, and also in these cases with degeneration without mineralization, you can see embolization within the spinal cord blood vessels, like in dogs or large cattle. So that in Belgians with emboli within the blood vessels, and then ischemic necrosis. And then we have a series of masses inducing spinal cord compression. That's a peripheral nerve sheath tumor that Dr. Baker at UPenn dissected late 90s and was inducing compressions of the spinal cord. Actually, that's a synovial cyst. We also had some peripheral nerve sheath tumors. Actually, that's a synovial cyst, which is rare, but is well described, sorry. Synovial cyst inducing compression of the spinal cord. Dr. Baker case, great case. Melanoma. Melanoma in horses will go to the bones, will go to especially to vertebral bodies, and will compress the spinal cord. So in addition to all the classic locations, skin, lymph nodes, parotid glands, eyes, intrathoracic, spleen ilus, you'll find it here. Pathognomonic, right? In horses. Amelanoma and melanoma are extremely rare in horses. There are three types, the juvenile on the skin, melanocytomas, the multicentric or metastasizing melanoma of gray horses, or horses with some gray in the coat, and then the rare, three cases in my life, hypomelanotic melanoma. Some people describe also amelanotic melanoma, but I never had a case, maybe I missed them. Hemangiosarcoma, same propensity, tendency to colonize the bones of horses, joint, bones, gums. Sometimes horses are born with hemangiosarcoma, there is a congenital form. In this case, inducing compressive degenerative myelopathy. See, the tumor is bulging within the spinal canal, big mass outside, and then here in the middle, and then expanding. Dr. Baker again. Can tell you how many horses we examined together, huh? And then that's the peripheral nerve sheath tumor again, Dr. Baker, lucky case. And then where this tumor was progressively growing, compressing the spinal cord. See, I like to give credit to my colleagues. Each slide that is not mine, I like to put their names because we spend a lot of time doing these things. And, you know, this probably was 2 hour work at least. And then it's taking the things out. And then you're on your knees in feces and blood taking the pictures. And then there is the picture selection. Then there is the... So it's you know, each picture is for us our little artwork, and I think each investigator deserves proper recognition. So recognizing your colleagues at the beginning of the lecture, at the end of the lecture is essential, but even if you wanna do something really good, you put them on the slide and you mention them. And how do you know if someone is good? Because these days, in times of internet, anybody can put together a presentation. Anybody can take the picture or a book and put it together, start traveling around and saying, teaching you equine pathology, which would be fine, as long as you mention who gave you the pictures. But to identify, I think, a good professional, not necessarily me, everybody, you need to ask them, well, where did you work? What you do? What you did? How many cases you had? And show me your pictures, show me your collection. That's define us, right? That's my humble opinion. It's written lymphoma and looks hemorrhagic. Well, that was a lymphoma with hemorrhage. We don't know what caused the hemorrhage, probably a trauma. Don't expect all the lymphomas with hemorrhage. It's happened to be a lymphoma. And histologically, you find B cell, T cell, some cells don't stain. So there are some B cell lymphoma generally in the brain, mainly T cells, with exception. Often with the markers we use, which are, they stay in the pretty much in the finger of a hand, CDs, CD3, CD20, BLA36, CD79A, and a few other with frozen section. You know, characterization is always limited. Also because when you see a human study on lymphoma, they use 25 markers. And they spend $15,000. So. But meningeal lymphoma in horses, cerebral lymphoma, cerebrospinal lymphoma is a sporadic event. And sometimes at the beginning they mimic other diseases. Sometimes when they're in the mild, incipient form, they mimic encephalitis, like a case I had in 96 in Cornell, where the brain lesions were called by specialists encephalitis, the tree mother tissue, and there was neoplastic lymphocytic infiltration, and we realized that that infiltration was cerebral lymphoma. Dr. Summer wrote a paper about cerebral meningeal lymphoma in horses. And this is a nerve, and along the nerve, lots of neoplastic lymphocytes separating the fibers. Which kind of viral disease this would mimic in the, if this infiltration, so severe infiltration would be in the brain around blood vessels? Which is the viral disease of horses characterized by prominent foci? Borne, yes, borne virus. More in his nerve. A somehow have an histiocytic appearance. Difficult to understand if they are histiocytic, histiocyte, if they are lymphocytes that are degenerating, or they are lymphocytes with a histiocytic appearance. Anyway, small and medium lymphocytes, often they're all small, and indistinguishable from an inflammatory infiltrate. Interesting case of pituitary tumor, where lymphoma started and then invaded the base of the brain. So primary lymphoma in the pituitary gland, nowhere else, and then whoop, within the thalamus. So three tumors, because there was pituitary gland, then some adenoma so the pituitary tumor was in the pars intermedia, which is the most common presentation in horses that get older, classic. Any horse that get, you know, old enough, develop a pituitary tumor, a hyperplasia of pituitary tumor. And then there was also a couple of small adenomas which were in the pars distali, plus lymphoma starting with pituitary gland with invasion of the brain. So three tumors in one cell. Cross-section. And this could be a picture of Cornell University, could be also a case I had in Newmarket in 92. the 30-year-old horse of a rock star. I don't mention the rock star, but very famous in England, very nice guy. And Sella Turcica, Turkish saddles with this large pituitary tumor. Actually, no, this is the same tumor then in cross-section. You see the lymphoma. And then in mules, you can have some strange brain proliferation that you don't see in horses. There are some vascular malformation, the meninges in horses. There is an interesting manuscript from California where they showed this blood vessel malformation along the meninges with clinical signs that we saw also later in the early 2000s. And these are mule with vascular malformations. At the beginning I thought it was hemangiosarcoma or hemangioma, not just vascular malformation. Very old mule in the cerebellum. And this mule, so in addition to this vascular amartoma, which can be seen also in other species, including dogs, small size. That's the pineal gland of this mule, and this is a close-up of this pinealoma. Same pineal gland tissue histologically, just huge. It was like this, like 2 tons put together, all new. Doesn't qualify for horse, but qualify for equine pathology, so I put it. Then, occasionally, you see thickening of the nerve roots in the lomosacral area, and you see these changes, and then often the horse present with instability, urinary bladder paralysis, even rupture, and uroperitoneum. And histologically, these nerves are emphasized and suffocated by a proliferation of osteocytes, lymphocytes, plasma cells, in some cases even neutrophils with necrosis. And this is a detail on a particularly good case. See, on the publication, they describe the fibrosis, they describe the macrophages, lymphocytes, plasma cells, sometimes the multinucleated giant cells, but not frequently they describe this necrosis with neutrophils. So I got pretty excited when I got these couple of cases without neutrophils. I said, well, where do you see in the horse and other animal, neutrophils, necrosis, multinucleated giant cells, macrophages? Which kind of equine lesion you see that? You start eliminating fungi, yeast, viruses don't induce lesion like this, although there are some British investigators 30, 35 years ago speculated that an adenovirus may be causing this because they found some adenovirus particularly high titers. Adenoviruses are not pathogenic in horses except in skid folds. If you see a lesion like this in the lung, what's your differential diagnosis? Lung, pyoromatous, rhodococcus. And remember, salmonella occasion. So I did a special stain histochemistry, immunohistochemistry, rhodococcus, other bacteria. Look for any kind of possible agent. Did PCR for multiple viruses. Zero. So it's still idiopathic. 4 cases, 5 cases in the career, so sporadic. And this poor guy, this poor horse, had, because of this condition, had bladder paralysis and rupture of the urinary bladder. The rupture occurred on the cranial pole of the bladder. Bladder expands, and there is ischemic necrosis of the tip, and then rupture, because more than a perforation is a rupture, because there is necrosis of the tip and then opens up. And this horse will live a few days with uroperitoneum. And then, interestingly, that's all urine in the abdominal cavity. And there will be a coating, a sandy calcium carbonate coating of the peritoneum associated with this urine. Kind of sandy. We cannot discuss completely equine neuropathology without mentioning the roarers and without mentioning the progressive left cricoridoideus muscle atrophy due to degeneration and changes in the left recurrent laryngeal nerve. Rarely the lesion can be bilateral, but generally it's unilateral, left of course. and the horse future is related to laryngoplasty. And classic linga presentation, classic gross pictures, gross image. And make sure you check these two muscles. Actually, I generally collect this and drop it in formalin as it is. Look at it, even if it's normal, it's an area I collect. Here I collect tongue, I collect laryngeal follicles, the Valdaier area, epiglottis. I'm a little bit paranoid about this thing, so. And I learned from Dr. Whitwell, Dr. Farrell in Ireland, and others to collect a lot. Small pieces, but it's there. And then you collect, you can scoop them out, left and right. You can collect the left, and left a bigger specimen. How do you recognize left and right in your formal bucket without tagging? Well, just you, as convention, you keep bigger the specimens on one side. Professor King in Cornell University told me to keep the left specimen bigger, and told me a little story that I cannot report these days, how to remember that the left needs to be larger. And but that's a way you remember. You can do it in a different way, and so you can collect your specimen here. Very important, because this is frequent, and you may miss some horses with mild lesions, which can be significant for the insurance of the horse. And histology, you're going to see the classic small fiber, small triangular fiber, small group atrophy. And you can follow the nerve and see if you can detect some degeneration. Which are the horses predisposed to this? Large breeds, Belgians, big drafts. I saw this lesion in a couple of Irish drafts, but also other normal-sized horses, Thoroughbreds and Standardbreds, can have the same changes. Generally, unilateral left, rarely bilateral. And that's the case. Not one of the worst. Fibers that are rounded, not too big, so already abnormal here, and here the small groups. Unmistakable. And also check for the nerve cross-section. You may see a few fibers that are missing. I took this picture in England. Put everything together. Chromatolysis of the esophageal, intestinal, enteric, and colonic, especially colonic ganglia. And then you find this viscous digesta in the cecum, and then when you reach the colon, you can play tennis with these fecal balls. Of course, there are several names. In South America, this is called mal seco, dry disease. In the books, this is called dysautonomia, horses. So it's called equine dysautonomia. In England, it's called grass sickness. And Catherine Whitwell, great pathologist and very good horse person, and very good, very observant lady that she is, she noted that horses, in the paddocks of horses with this condition, they were finding also dead hair, you know, lepus species, and they start doing necropsies on these hairs. And she found the same lesions in the ganglia of this hair that she found in the horses. So there was something in the grass of those paddocks that obviously was inducing this chromatolysis. But I think any British in the audience, correct me if I'm wrong, after 30 years and more, we still don't know what it is. And was Clostridium was big in the past, but now Clostridium is out of the door. The good thing is that there was plenty of money spent for equine research, is always a good thing, because horses are great animals, fantastic things. So we still don't know. Horses still die of mal seco grass sickness, and you know, it's I suspect something mycotic, maybe something related to some arthropods, but hey, it's everything in the British hands to solve, because fortunately, there are very few cases in Europe, and they're mainly in England, British Islands in general, and South America. So, A few cases were very similar to equine motor neuron disease, but in reality, the two diseases are very well separated and distinguished. And if we are talking about necrosis of the ganglia here, histologically, we want to mention absence of ganglia. This is a model of the human Hirschsprung disease, colonic ganglionosis. These poor overall foals are born with no colonic ganglia because they got a defect on neural crest. So neural crests don't produce sufficient number of melanocytes. That's the reason, because they are white, little white. They're not albino, because they still have pigmentation on the muscle and around the eyes, but they're pretty whitish. And then, unfortunately, the small, fortunately, the small intestine has ganglia, but the large intestine doesn't. So the meconium, the digester, don't progress, and we get this meconium patch, and these poor little creatures needs to be euthanized because they would develop horrible pain, colitis with horrible pain, and generally clostridia take over and induce hemorrhagic necrosis in this area of impaction. Overall, I provide you, in addition to my presentations, if you didn't get something, not presentation, summary presentation, multiple slides on a page, also provide you some text of pretty much sparse equine pathology. There is, I provide you my handout of a very large 6-hour presentation of all the gross lesions you can see in horses that I use for courses to residents and to colleagues. And over there is additional information. There are pretty much all the pictures gross pictures I've been using here. So you can find there also the pathogenesis of conditions. So I don't remember the genetics of this condition that I knew very well a few years ago, but they are in the handouts I provide. Megaesophagus, Dr. Langer, present in the room here, knows everything about esophageal lesion horses, because in Michigan, they get a lot of draft horses with esophageal issues. And there is an interesting manuscript on veterinary pathology about it. So large breeds are predisposed to megaesophagus, thickening and dilatation. In this case, there was a muscle atrophy of the esophagus. And interestingly, this case should hit the press, because there was, on one side, there was atrophy with clear loss of fibers and small angular fiber atrophy, but the innervation was increased. So on one side, there was atrophy of the smooth muscle and skeletal muscle, and the other side, there was a dysplasia, hyperplasia of the fiber with disorganization. So megaesophagus with interesting gross and histologic features, something I never seen before in any other species. So, like in other species, remember, megaesophagus sporadic in horses, except a breed. What's the name of the breed, Belgian?
Frisian.
Frisian horses are predisposed to esophageal dysplastic change. What's happened to this case? Well, it's happened that they can develop diverticuli, ruptures, dysphagia, and there is dysphagia, inhalation pneumonia. Pulmonitis ab ingestis. Someone studied on the same books I studied in the 80s. String hold. Difficult to find changes in string hold cases. Sciatic, peroneal, and tibial nerves, peripheral neuropathy, associated with sweet pea poison in USA, laterism, flatweed intoxication in Australia, or unknown. I saw cases when I was a vet student around Milan. I dissected any fiber of that horse, didn't find anything. Dramatic clinical sign. So I remember two forms, or three. Local with poisonings. These are the final slide with not much images. Oxytropis, astragalus, all type of livestock, horses, cattle, small ruminants. You can have abortion, perinatal mortality, congenital defects, which are myelination, arthrogryposis, neural vocalization, and death. Cases I didn't have experience in my life, but I want to share with you. And then here is a paper of Dr. Stegelmeier and collaborators of veterinary pathology with some changes you can find in the cerebellum in case of certain type of plant toxicity, as I mentioned before. And then, hey, there are also some tumors that are considered significant for the CNS, like this occasionally we see on the nerves, on the nerve roots, like I show you before in that picture, Dr. Abeker, we see peripheral nerve sheath tumors, which is, we can emphasize with immunohistochemical stains, here in the skin, also near nerves. And that would be the tip of the iceberg of equine neuropathology, because we could have, that was, you know, a kind of a brief evaluation. We could be going much more details, and maybe there's a few entities that didn't touch sufficiently. And that's a hand. These are rock that, I got two favorite islands in the world, and they are my island, where my family is from originally, which is Kerso, Kres, and where is the grave of my ancestors, the Mitis family on my mother's side. And that's the reason, because I'm very attached also to the Balkania as a plain, as a great place to where I spent my youth, and I still go with a lot of pleasure. And this another island is Sardinia, where I got quite a few friends, where I'm going in a few weeks to present more stuff. And the rocks of this cliffs here, and these islands, small islands, are very similar to the same formation you see in the Dalmatian coast. And sometimes you see animals like elephant, cattle. In this case, is a hand. So raise your hand if you have any question. Any question? Please. So two cases where the lesions histologically suggest equine herpes virus infection.
Yes.
Most likely EHV1.
One.
Yeah, okay.
But the PCR, it was done for EHV1 and 4. And it was negative.
Okay, PCR is negative. PCR, if you don't do any pathological examination, especially in histology, PCR is the most sensitive technique to detect EH1 in the spinal cord. The problem is that the virus spreads in small quantity, like West Nile virus, sometimes even less, often in a few endothelial cells. So little virus, like I show in my immunohistochemistry, which had virus, but not much, can produce dramatic lesions. And small lesions can be associated with dramatic clinical signs. So if you collect blindly segment of spinal cord for PCR, even worse for virus isolation, you can get some negative results, which is not the fault of the person that collects the tissue, it's not the fault of the molecular virologist, it's not just what it is. So in these cases, you find lesions due to EHV1, that suggest EHV1, you wanna look for your paraffin block where there is a swollen endothelial cells, and hope that the virus is there. You wanna do some shaving of that tissue in paraffin and send it to a very good molecular biology lab where they can work on this type of technique, extract the DNA. It's a DNA virus, so it will be present in your specimen. It's not labeled like RNA, and you may get the virus out. You can start with a generic herpes virus, or you can directly go for EHV1. Immunohistochemistry may help doing multiple sections, but may not. So often histology is the only answer. And also another good way to detect the virus, to detect virus actions is to do serology at the same time, even postmortem, because fortunately the cases of mild encephalopathy due to AG1 will have a high titer. So little lesions, virus present, virus detectable or not, but good seroconversion, 4 times. So I sometimes even collect blood postmortem, ask the clinician to give them the blood that what they did clinically. So that would be my, and then, hey, since we, you're from Slovenia, so you're my neighbor. Actually, you are born in around Trieste, so pretty much you are citizens of the same area. Different languages, same DNA. Hybrid vigor, feel free to send me some slides, some pictures when I go back home.
Did you do serology on CSF?
Was that?
Did you do serology on CSF?
I didn't, and I knew at the Animal Health Trust they did quite a bit of work on this in the early 90s, but I forgot the results. I mean, I would do it. I you got me on this. I need to go back and study CNS, CSF, and presence of antibodies. I did cytology on the cerebrospinal fluid in EH1 cases and West Nile. And I found some pleocytosis, and not more than this. So, and I didn't find the virus. EH1, I didn't look for it, but I looked for West Nile, and I didn't find antigen, and I didn't find via PCR, and I didn't find it with immunohistochemistry. I didn't find it with immunohistochemistry, I didn't find it with PCR. And also virus isolation, a couple of cases in 2000 was negative, which means nothing because virus isolation for these two agents is very challenging. Some people got it up. I remember a couple of cases I sent from Kentucky. I sent to Kentucky in the mid-2000s. They were even able to isolate the virus on the spinal cord, which is pretty cool. So, but there was also more antigen. So sorry for an incomplete answer to your question. Interesting question. Now the problem is that my ignorance on the topic is recorded. Yes.
Yes, Fabio. If we are continuing the previous question about the volunteer, if we get PCR negative and immuno positive, we will get the opposite. PCR positive, immuno negative, and histological, we will confirm the critical reasons.
Yes.
That maybe we are in the very early phase of the disease, we have viremia. And during the taking of the same group, maybe we detect
So if I got the comment and question, which is very interesting, there are some cases where the host is kept in the hospital, where you can still have the lesions visible histologically, but it's PCR negative and virological negative because the virus is gone, and you've got the lesions left. Because this lesion continue also when the infection is apparently gone. So if I interpret your comment, yes, there are some cases in which histopathology is the possibly associated with serology because it's a weapon you need to consider. Anytime you got neurology course, get the blood. I mean, it would be so you can have your serum for your additional procedures. That's the only way to detect the disease. So it's a, and also you can go by exclusion. Sometimes I diagnose EPM on horses that have been treated by exclusion. So I see the lesions, they're non-specific perivascular, we had few plasma cells. Plasma tells me that it's not a virus, so I'm already got this advantage. Although I had a case of EHV1 years ago with 2 plasma cells. I have the slides there, I should take a picture as a relic. And so what I do PCR for EHV1, I do PCR for, I send it to our diagnostic laboratory lab that does that. We do hysteric encephalitis, we do West Nile, and but we look at all the tissues, CNS, to see any other change, and then eventually we produce a presumptive but strong presumptuous diagnosis for EPM after all these negative results. So diagnosis by exclusion is a way to go. Some people can laugh about it, but hey, that's pathology. Yep. And then eyes very important. Yeah. Did I interpret your comment well? I have a great story to tell you. I mean, great for me because I like this thing, so pay for use body. In the mid-2000s, in a place in the United States where I was working, they had a horse that became ataxic and was shedding EHV1 from the nose. So they did the rhinopharyngeal swab, you know, in horses, you wanna go deep, and you start, you don't wanna go, you know, like when you pick your nose, you wanna go in, because the head is very long, so there is this long swab that I think was created at the Animal Health Trust years ago to collect, well, the rhinopharyngeal exudates. You go in, you get your good specimen, even more than one, you cut the tip, you put in virus isolation medium, and then you send it to the lab. Well, they got EHV1 with PCR. So, a taxi horse shedding EHV1, what they do? They shut down the racetrack. Horse gets even more severe clinical sign. They euthanize the horse and send it to me. Autopsy. So I was me on duty on a weekend with the racetrack of this state. That was very important. So everything. So the days that these places were staying closed in quarantine was depending on my confirmatory diagnosis. Or, so I was going to prove or disprove this case. But they had already, the authority didn't care because they had already this EHV1 positive patient. So they had neurologic disease, shedding herpes virus, 1 + 1 = 2, pathognomonia. Well, I examined the whole horse, I demolished it. I finished the autopsy at 10:30 at night, pull out the spinal cord, get some fresh tissues for possible virus isolation, molecular biology, put the tissues in formalin, and then I get very tiny sections, and I get some formalin, dangerous stuff, don't do it at home, get a formalin container in glass, fire resistant, and I brought the formalin at a high temperature, and I dropped the specimens. So the formalin penetrated very quickly. You don't have great morphology, but you get a quick fixation. I learned this from Dr. Whitwell at Newmarket, a British invention, a British trick. So I was able to stick quickly the specimens in the paraffin blocks in the automatic stainer in time, to get pretty much the specimen the following day. And I didn't see any lesions, histologically, the day after, which is very unusual. Because with a viral disease, if you do your right sectioning, you should find some lesions, mild, but it should be homogeneously distributed. You may find some segment without lesions, but generally, brainstem, cervical, thoracic, thoracolumbar, you should see EHV1 lesions. So, the following day, I said, darn it, there are no lesions here, that's very unusual. So I went back to the spinal cord, I trim, until I found an area where there was a little bit of reddish discoloration in the thoracolumbar area. I took several sections there, in addition I prepared other sections. So the following day I was busy with this, and I found no lesions in the spinal cord except that spot that had lymphocytes, plasma cells, eosinophils. So it was a case of ataxia due to sarcoidosis neurona that, since the poor horse was stressed, was shedding herpes virus 1. On this proof, and in absolute other cases, after 2 days, they could remove the veto, how do you say in good English? They in Italian would be dissequestro. So they could open again the rest. So this tells you that you need to be fast. You need to be complete. You need to know the disease. You need to use all the techniques that you have. And you don't want to trust clinical. You want to respect your colleagues because they're great, but you want to trust all the clinical virological, microbiological findings that you get. So you want to always prove pathology. So it's and then I follow up. I send the spinal cord to Kentucky. Was negative for PCR. Serology will say was also at a mild titer, which indicate respiratory infections. In that case, not certainly neurologic infection, roughly. And then the whole story had a happy ending, but it was a very interesting case. Stress horse, EPN, shedding herpes virus. In any other place, probably, this case would have been dismissed with like a EG1 myelopathy. It was a famous virologist that studied flaviviral diseases. When you get a positive serology from a horse, West Nile virus, Eastern European encephalitis, herpes virus, if you base your diagnosis on that dead horse with serology only, Santa even virus identification, this could be a dead horse that has got a positive serology, but the horse could be still dead because it hit a truck. You see, so it's always, you know, always do your, all your pathological examination in these cases. Any other question? Good. Well, I like questions. So what shall we do next? We stop for lunch or shall I keep going? What's that? Okay, and then we start a bit early because we got a long way to go. Okay, so thank you.